Austria, I think. Only 2 days. I just, I can't see.
That's good.
I don't like it. Uptight than Germans. Also, I was trying to find this last one, so it's like. I got a good crowd. Hostel is down. This sucks. Yeah, and then like girls.
Hello. So I wanted to make a few announcements. The first one is about homework number one. So those are the 3 exercises that I'm asking you to do for the homework. The first 2 are analytic exercises. I think the first one is simply all of the properties of symmetric matrices that we talked about in class. And the second one is computing a lot of matrix derivatives. Okay. The last exercise, that is a programming exercise. So I'm going to ask you to code PCA and apply it to face images. The exercise in the book has a lot of extra stuff that we haven't covered in class. In particular, it asks you to do probabilistic PCA, which we haven't covered yet. So that's what I'm writing there, that you're going to take that exercise and do only the part that pertains to PCA, not the other parts. Okay? So by and large, the exercise will be implement PCA. That should be very, very short. And then it would be take a database of images and apply PCA to the images, plot the mean, plot the principal components, and a few questions about that. Okay? That, if you don't have a lot of experience in programming, can take time, so I would encourage to start early with that one. But the other ones should not be that long. Like the exercise 2 had a lot of parts, but it's just a lot of derivative computation, just to warm you up of all of the kinds of derivatives that I'm doing with that. Okay. It'll be due on February 20th, which is Monday. I'll make it due at the end of the day so that we have time for a lecture on that Monday, and I'll have office hours on that Monday as well. I'll ask the TA to have office hours next week so that if there are questions about the homework. Perhaps, in fact, could we do next Friday here at the time of the lecture, since I won't be here? Could you come for questions about the homework? Okay. So let me write that down. So no class next week, but office hours or TA hours Friday, 12 to 1:15. Okay? So that way, next Friday, you will have time to ask him questions, and I'll have office hours on the Monday, the 20th, for last minute questions. Okay? Then next week there'll be no classes on Monday, and you will have TA hours on Friday. And as I had announced in the first lecture, the makeup classes will be on Wednesday at the same time in this same room. I said in the first lecture that there may be some conflicts, and I didn't want everybody in the first lecture to tell me the conflicts because you might not stay for the class. But I wanted to ask today if there are any conflicts with Wednesday at the same time in this same room. You have conflicts? Okay, can you send me an email? Okay, if you both send me emails, I'll see what I can do.
These are seminars.
LCSR, yes. So one of the reasons I put the class Monday, Friday as opposed to the usual Monday, Wednesday is precisely to avoid the clashes with LCSR seminars. But this is sort of exceptional, so hopefully it won't. Right. That's exactly why we have a class on Fridays. But because I'm traveling next week, this would be exceptional. So please send me an email if you have conflict, and we will try to figure it out. Okay. Any other questions so far before I begin the lecture?
Is there a class on Monday, you said?
This next Monday, 3 days from now, there will be no class. The Friday, 1 week from now, there will be TA hours here. And then we'll resume as well. Okay.
Any specific instructions for submitting?
So I'll post all of the instructions online, but exercise 1 and 2 are analytical exercises, so you just write them down. And for the exercise 3, I'll send the instructions, but by and large it'll be sent an email with a zip file, and there will be a specific file structure that I'll request. Okay. But if you want to get ahead, it's probably going to be identically the same instructions as last year. So if you just look at homework 1 from last year, you'll see. But I just didn't have time to put them all this morning on the website. Okay. Any other questions? All right. Okay, so we are covering now geometric PCA. And we had already formulated the problem last time. So the idea is that we have a subspace, S, and that we have a cloud of points that lie approximately in that subspace. And so the subspace is denoted as the set of points, X, such that X is equal to a mean vector times a basis and a log-dimensional representation, where mu belongs to RT, in fact, mu. And U is d by d, and y is a vector in R linear. Okay, that's the representation of an affine subspace. We had said that we are given a collection of points, xj, that are equal to mu plus u times yj plus some error, epsilon j, where epsilon j belongs to RT. And we even ended the previous lecture by setting up the optimization problem. And the optimization problem is find the subspace, S, that best fits the data points. And by best fitting, what we want is to minimize that error, and that's epsilon j. And so we minimize the sum of the square of the errors. So sum j equals 1 to the number of points of the errors, and the errors in this particular case is xj minus mu minus u times yj. 2 norm squared. And we will minimize that with respect to the subspace, which is parameterized by mu and u, but also with respect to the log dimensional coordinates. So that's the optimization problem we need to solve. And we spent some time in the previous lecture saying that this problem is not well posed, that the solution might not be unique. We said that one of the causes for that is that if this is the origin, the mu is some vector in the subspace, and that vector is not unique. I could have chosen any point in the subspace. And so to avoid that, we argued in the previous lecture that we're going to require the low-dimensional representation to be centered. And by centered, we mean that the average of the y's, we will assume that it's equal to zero. And that will eliminate what I call the translational ambiguity, which is due to the fact that the location of that point in the subspace is absolutely arbitrary. Okay? One of you asked me, well, isn't that too much of a constraint? Am I overimposing, and now the solution might not be feasible? I said no, and I said we're going to see that because we're going to get the solution and it's going to work out. But a different way to answer the question is intuitively, just by accounting argument. What is the ambiguity? The ambiguity is that location of that new vector. And that new vector can be anywhere in the subspace, and it's absolutely arbitrary location. So how many degrees of freedom do I have in the location of that point? Can anyone tell me? 1 degree of freedom, 2 degree of freedom? What is that translational ambiguity? How many degrees of freedom is it?
D.
D. Which one? Big D or small d?
Small d.
Hmm? Small d. How many say that it's big D? Okay, why is big D?
Because your mu is a vector in big D.
Yes, okay, so mu is a vector in R, capital D. Now, someone said small d. Why small d? Yes, even though it's a vector in R big D, it is a point in the subspace. So the subspace says the subspace has dimension little d. Okay, so in this constraint now is a constraint. How many equations am I imposing in here? Little d, because the y vector is in little d. So it's like I have an ambiguity of little d, and I'm imposing little d constraints. The other ambiguity that I talked about is that also I can rotate or make a change of basis on the subspace, okay? And we agreed upon the fact that I would require the basis to be orthonormal. Okay, so the basis in principle can be arbitrary. Out of all bases, I'm going to choose one that is orthogonal. And we also discussed the fact that that's not enough because I would still be able to rotate this low-dimensional representation. And I said, you're right, but believe me, I'll have a way of handling that as I do the derivation, okay? So for the time being, I'm going to be happy with this formulation, and what I'm going to try to do now is to derive what the optimal subspace is. And I'll handle the non-uniqueness in a moment. Okay, so let me then say also that this problem is, in principle, a very difficult optimization problem. And the reason is the following. In optimization, as you might have learned, easy problems, quote unquote, are problems that are differentiable and convex. Particularly, convexity is one key thing for being an easy optimization problem. This problem is actually non-convex. And there are two sources of non-convexity that show up. The first one is that I've got this multiplication. The u and the y are multiplied with each other. And both of them are variables that I need to compute. The second one is this orthogonality constraint, that is a set of quadratic constraints. Okay? If the u was just one vector, as opposed to the entire basis for the subspace, this would be, the u would need to be in the sphere. Okay? So the sphere is a non-convex set. So in principle, this problem is hard and non-convex. But as we will see in today's lecture, it's one of those very few difficult optimization problems for which actually we get very lucky and we get a closed form solution. Okay. So let me go through the steps of computing the solution. So what I'm going to do, first of all, is to write down the Lagrangian. The Lagrangian will be j minus mu, mu times y j squared, sum j over minus n. So I need to put the objective plus lambda times the constraint,
plus the dot product between lambda and the sum of the y sub i. Y sub j. Sorry, this should be a j. Okay? So we said objective plus lambda times the constraint. We have now many constraints, and so it's lambda 1, constraint 1, lambda 2, constraint 2, lambda n, or lambda d, constraint d. And so it is really a dot product between a vector of Lagrange multipliers and the constraint itself, okay? Plus, and we've got the last one, dot product. This is now a matrix constraint. So dot product between a matrix of Lagrange multipliers and the constraint itself. And we always write the constraint in a way that is f of something is equal to 0. So that's why this one was trivial, because it was already f of something is equal to 0. This one is not trivial, so I need to do identity minus that is equal to 0. Okay. And I already discussed this in the previous lecture. I said that there is some redundancy here because this equation is symmetric. So there are lots of constraints that are repeated, all of the orthogonality constraints. And so all of the upper diagonal and the lower diagonal are the same. And so the lambda matrix, to compensate for that and not to have repeated constraints, we concluded at the end of the lecture that I needed this matrix to be symmetric. And we went into that discussion. And this is exactly where we ended in the previous lecture. So let me begin by computing the derivative of L with respect to mu. Okay. So the derivative mu only appears in the first term. And the first thing is that there is a quadratic. So something squared, the derivative of something squared, the derivative of x squared is 2 times x. So this is going to be 2 times the sum from j equals 1 n of xj minus mu times y. Okay. Derivative of x squared is 2x. So I did the 2x already. Times the derivative of what's inside with respect to mu. And that would be
minus 1.
So I'll just put a minus there. And this is. So from here, I get that mu is equal to the sum. Actually, maybe I should do this step by step so that you don't get lost. So I get here the following. The sum of mu is equal to the sum of xj minus u times yj. Right? That's what I get. Correct? So on the left, I get n times mu. And here I get the sum of the xj's minus u times the sum of the yj's. Correct? And fortunately, this guy is 0. So I get that mu, this is my optimal mu, is just 1 over n sum of the xj's. So as it turns out, the mu parameter is just the average of the data points. And that comes out to be very intuitive, because all what's going on really is that, and we're going to see that in a second now, all I need to do is to subtract the mean from the data before I get stuck. Okay? So in fact, given that, I can go back to my objective and say, see, in the objective, everywhere, it's x minus mu, x minus mu, x minus mu, everywhere. Now I know what mu is, so I'm going to define, if you wish, x tilde j to be xj minus mu. Okay? So that's going to be the centered data. And once I do that,
the objective becomes, the L becomes immediately the sum j is 1 to n of xj tilde minus u times yj, plus all of the rest that I'm not going to repeat. Okay. 2n squared. Okay. So, if I go ahead, and so look at what happened. All what this operation says is, I'm going to put mu hat. And so all what this operation says is take your data and subtract the mean before you get started. And now we have an easier quote-unquote optimization problem. So what I'm going to do is to define just the data matrix to be exactly x1 minus mu hat, x2 minus mu hat, and xn minus mu hat. That's going to be my centered data matrix. I'm going to define the matrix of low-dimensional coordinates to be y1, yn. And with that matrix notation, the L now will become x minus u times y, Frobenius squared. Right? Because I had said in the earlier lectures, what is the Frobenius norm of a matrix? Lots of ways to define it, but the basic is that it's the sum of the square of the entries. Frobenius norm is the sum of the square of the entries. A separate way to define it is sum of the squares of the norms of the columns. All right? What is x minus u times y? Column by column. It's exactly this minus u times y. It's exactly this objective. Okay? So x minus u times y is just the matrix of errors, while this quantity here would just be the ith column of that error. So the error for the jth point. Okay? Okay. Plus what we already have. So lambda dot product between lambda and sum of the yj's plus lambda identity minus u transpose u. Okay? So what I'm going to do now is to compute the derivative of L with respect to the matrix Y. The derivative of L with respect to Y. What is that? Again, x squared. The derivative of x squared is 2 times x. So I'm going to write exactly that 2 times x. Okay? Is that clear? The derivative of x squared is 2 times x. Times the derivative of what's inside, okay, with respect to y. So what is the derivative of x minus uy with respect to y? Minus u. Oh. Any other opinions? Minus u transpose. Okay, I've got two possible answers so far, minus u and minus u transpose. And now, well, where do I put either the u or the u transpose?
Mm-hmm. Put it in the front.
In the front? And what do I put, u or u transpose?
U transpose.
U transpose, yes. So that's exactly what you're going to learn by doing the homework, that you need to put u transpose on the left. Okay. How you might start guessing what that might be? Well, think about something like sum of a sub i's, y sub i's, for example. Okay? What is the derivative of that with respect to y as a vector?
and I need to write it as a column there.
So this is exactly A transpose Y.
Okay?
So if this is F, the derivative of F with respect to Y, if my convention is that I will put it as a vector, this will be exactly A. Okay? So typically, in fact, another way to do it is that when you have something like this with a vector, the derivative of the dot product of Y with something else will be exactly A. But when they're multiplying each other, see what I had to do? The derivative of this with respect to Y, you could have said, oh, it's A transpose. But no, it needs to be A because my convention is that I'm going to put it as a vector. Okay? By analogy, the same intuition is what's going on here. I need to compute the derivative of U times Y with respect to Y. You would have said it's U. But no, you need to transpose so that you preserve the same order. In a sense, what I want, I'm defining this by convention that this will be a matrix of dimension V by N. Okay, so I'm taking the derivative with respect to the matrix Y. The matrix Y has a lot of entries, and I'm taking the derivative with respect to all the entries simultaneously. And I would like the result to be a matrix of the same size as Y. Okay? That's why, you know, it just compute the dimensions here. So this is D by M. This is D by little d. This is D by N. Right? So X minus U times, this is going to be a D by N matrix. Once I multiply by U transpose, I'm going to get D by D in here. Right? And so the result of everything will be a D by N matrix, which is what I need. So that's another way to verify at the end of the day. You put dimensions and the dimensions need to match up. All right? So I'm not doing a foolproof that it needs to be U transpose, but that's exactly what you need to get used to as to why, and the homework will hopefully help with that. Okay. So we are there, and so what I get, and this, I'm not there, right? I have another term with U. Okay? So now I need to compute the derivative of this with respect to U. What is the derivative of that? Okay. Any ideas? Well, all right. It looks like U squared. If everything was scalar, it would be like lambda times u squared. Right. What would be the derivative of lambda times u squared with respect to u? It would be 2 lambda u, right? And with a minus in this case, right? So if I had to guess, I would say 2 lambda u. Okay. One way to check whether this makes sense or not is just verify the dimensions again, right? So this u matrix is d by d, and this is going to be d by d, right? So I have a little d by little d equation. So this lambda matrix is little d by little d. Okay? So if this is there like that, probably doesn't work, right? Right? You see that the dimensions don't match up? So in fact, the lambda needs to go on the right. Okay. Yes?
I'm not sure I followed. So I thought we were taking the derivative with respect to y. So why do you think
that? Ah. Because I'm stupid. With respect to y, not with respect to u. All right, so with respect to y. So what is this? This is the sum of the columns. So you can write this in matrix form as y times the vector of all ones. And now I've got the dot product. I'm sorry. No, I should say that I was just thinking ahead, and I was already doing the next three. That would sound better. Okay, so what is the derivative of this with respect to y? Okay. This is going to be a good one. So here I'm going to teach you another little trick. So what we have is lambda dot product with y, and with 1, correct? Is that clear? So, this is, by definition of dot product, Well, one possibility to write it down is lambda transpose y1, right? That's one way to write it down, right? But we can also write it down as the trace of lambda transpose y1, correct? Because a scalar or the trace of a scalar is the same thing. And I already start to play games with you in the first few lectures by saying, ah, but you can move those things around. So this is sort of trace L y times 1 times lambda transpose. Right? It's the same thing. Right? Because the trace of AB is equal to the trace of BA. Right? Cool. So now, this is essentially, now it should be easy, right? In fact, I can probably write this. What else could I do? Well, I could actually move this to the other side now. So this is also the same thing as the trace of 1 lambda transpose y. Right? I can just move the, I can move now y over there. Right? And this is the same thing now as the dot product between lambda times 1 transpose and 1. In fact, maybe I could have done that almost at the very beginning. Like I started here. And so what this is saying is that you can put that in there with a transpose. Okay? So now it should be easier. What is the game? What am I trying to do? This is all, you know, just playing games. But what I'm really trying to do, if in matrices, I can write things as just the dot product of something with something, then I know I can read off the derivative. Because what is the derivative of this with respect to y? I already told you, you will get a. So if I could write this damn thing as y times dot product with something, the something would be the derivative, because it's a linear thing. Okay. So all I was doing is just playing around so that I get it as dot product of y with something else. That's the objective. So now you can read off the derivative. What is the derivative of this with respect to y? Exactly that. And so this is now plus lambda times 1 transpose. And I always like to verify dimensions at the end to make sure we didn't screw up. So what is the dimension of lambda? Lambda is the Lagrange multiplier for the little y's. What dimension is that? Little d or small d? Small d. So this is little z by 1. And the 1 vector, I actually wrote it there with dimension n so that you wouldn't forget how many 1's I'm putting in there. So this guy is 1 by n, right? So does it match? What am I doing again? Now we're good, I hope. This is all just... Okay, so now are we good? This is our final target dimension. So this is the only possibility. Okay? So I'm doing this for the first time, a little bit slow, but you just need to warm up. After the homework, you should just be faster than me. Okay, good. So that is supposed to be equal to 0 now. Right? Did I get it right now? There is no other y in the Lagrange anymore. So, what I'm going to do is two things. I'm going to multiply by 1 on the right. If I multiply by 1 on the right, I'm going to get minus 2 u transpose x minus u y times 1 plus lambda 1 transpose 1 is equal to 0. Is that right? I do dot product on the right by the vector of all 1's, of size n, if you want to be more specific. Okay? Back here? Okay. What is y times 1? What is y times 1?
0.
0. Y times 1 is the average of the y points. And that's one of our constraints. Okay? So what I get here is minus 2 u transpose x times 1. That's my first term. All right? Plus, and what is 1 transpose times 1? I've got a vector of dimension n, dot product with another vector of dimension n, and all other entries are equal to 1. What do I get? 1 dot 1? N, right? This is 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, n times. Okay, plus n, lambda times n is equal to 0. Okay? Okay, but what is now x times 1? X times 1 is the average of the x's, right? Almost, but remember what was my definition of x? The x matrix is the x minus the mu's, right? So this thing here is just the sum of xj's minus mu hat. That's what it is. Right? So it's the average of the centered data. What is the average of the centered data? What is the average of the centered data?
Zero.
Zero. That's what centered means. Okay? So bottom line is that all of this is now zero as well. And so, as a conclusion, I get that the Lagrange multiplier must be equal to zero. All right? So that's what we got. So now that I know that lambda is zero, what I'm going to do is this same equation again, and I'm going to multiply on the left by u transpose. Okay, so if I multiply on the left by u transpose, I'm going to get minus 2. No, actually, what am I going to do? No, I don't need to do anything. No, I don't need to do anything. I'm done. I'll just replace the fact that lambda is 0. And what do I get? I get that minus 2 u transpose x plus 2 u transpose u y is equal to 0. That's what I get now. Exactly this equation. All I did was to set lambda to 0. And just expand the first two terms. So that's it. But u transpose u, what is that? That's the identity. So from here, what I get is that y is equal to u transpose x. Or in coordinates, yj is equal to u transpose xj minus mu hat. That's what that means. Okay? So, okay, that was a lot of algebra, but what is the picture of what's really going on? I got my mu hat there at the center. I have a point xj that may be here, a little bit outside the subspace. And what I'm asking you is, how do you compute the low dimensional representation? It says, take the point, subtract the mean from it. So it says, compute this vector. Okay? So take the data point and subtract the mean. And then, the matrix U is an orthogonal matrix. That's one of the assumptions. If you multiply by u transpose, this u transpose matrix is D by capital D. So it starts with this vector that has dimension capital D. And what it will really do is effectively project it onto the subspace. Okay? And so the coordinates really are going to come But that's what the principal components end up being in this geometric case, is effectively the projection of the data onto the subspace, and just finding the coordinates in that subspace. And that's what this equation says. Take the data, subtract the mean, and project. So, I've done two out of the three things. I computed the mean, or the mu vector, and it turns out to be the mean of the data. I computed the low-dimensional coordinates, and they are simply obtained by projecting the center data onto the subspace. But I still don't have the basis for the subspace, the U matrix. And so, because I don't have U, I cannot compute Y. So the last step is to compute the derivative with respect to u. Okay. So that's what we're going to do now. So now the derivative of L with respect to u. What is it? So what we're going to do, in fact, is before I even compute the derivatives, I'm just going to substitute all of the solutions that I have so far. So L after this will become the following. I have x minus u times y, but y is u transpose x. And then this is Frobenius squared. Plus the y part, I don't care anymore. I already dealt with it. It's lambda identity minus u. Okay. That's my new Lagrangian, which is only a function of u. Right. So I'm going to expand upon this Lagrangian as follows. You know, again, this is matrices and Frobenius norm and fancy stuff, but just go to, I guess, high school, maybe. You had something a minus b squared. What is a minus b squared? The square of the first minus 2 times the first times the second plus the square of the second. Remember that? Yes? Okay. The square of the first is just going to be this thing squared. Okay? But when you do it with vectors, you do the norm of the first minus 2 times the dot product of the first with the second, right? So now it's exactly like that with matrices. The norm of the first minus 2 times the dot product between x and u transpose x, okay? Plus the norm of the second. And so the norm of the second will be u transpose x. Okay, so this term here, does it depend on u? No. So in fact, it's a constant, I don't care. This last term, okay, what happens? Suppose that I've got a vector, x. Suppose that I rotate it. Does it change the norm? No? Does it? No, in fact, I'm going to argue that this, I can get rid of the u's in here. But another way to see it is just spell out what does it mean to have, in fact. What I'm going to do is just to spell it out. The Frobenius norm is exactly equal to the trace. You remember that. I wrote that in some. Frobenius norm of A squared is equal to the trace of A transpose A. Okay? I did say that at some point in life, in a previous lecture. So that's exactly what I'm going to do here. The Frobenius norm of that is the trace of x transpose u transpose u, and then x. Is that right?
U transpose u.
X transpose u transpose, and then UU transpose. Like that? Okay. So the cool thing is that even though this is supposed to be a fourth order term with U to the fourth, because U transpose U is the identity, right? This becomes the trace of X transpose U, U transpose X. Okay. All right? So now I can take the derivative a little bit more easily. So the derivative of L with respect to U is going to be equal to what? All right, the derivative of this guy with respect to U? Zero. The derivative of this guy with respect to U? How do I do it? Well, how do I do it? Well, it looks like U squared or something like that. So it should probably be 2 times U, but then there's all of these x's, right? So maybe I should try to clean it up a little bit. So this would be something like trace of X transpose U transpose X. That's what it is, right? Is that clear? Oh, it looks the same as the one here. Right? So minus 2 times that. And so in fact, what I've got here is minus, at the end of the day, the Lagrangian becomes minus the trace of X transpose U, U transpose X, plus the trace of what I'm always left with. Well, or that dot product that I had earlier. Lambda, all right, here. Lambda identity minus U. Okay. So, how do I compute this derivative now with respect to U? Okay. Any ideas? Any ideas? Well, again, the intuition tells us we need to end up with something of the same dimension of U. That's the first thing. And so, the way I would do it is as follows. Again, we can move this guy over there, right? Okay? In fact, this is the best way to do it, really. I'm going to move that over there, and then I'm going to move that over there. So what I'm going to get then is X transpose. If I do that, U transpose. You agree that that's the same as that? Correct? I'm just going to move X over there. Now I'm going to move the U transpose. So I'm going to get U transpose X transpose U and trace of that. Okay? And then you are going to remember that this is the same thing as X transpose U dot product with U. Right? Is that clear? So that's, remember always my intuition, what I tell you. If you convert the thing to that, what you have on the left, that's exactly what the derivative is. Okay? This is just the intuition. Here is repeated twice, so that's why we need to actually do the calculation. But I will hope you believe me that the derivative you're going to get is exactly this, but 2 times, right? Because it's the U square, and so you need to do this twice. So the derivative of this is going to be minus 2 times X transpose. Which is exactly what was here. Let's do the intuitive calculations just to make sure we're all right. If everything was scalar, this would say x squared u squared. Do you agree with that? What is the derivative of x squared u squared with respect to u? 2x
squared,
2x squared u.
2x squared u.
All right. It's basic sanity check. Doesn't mean that it's correct, but it's a basic sanity check. Another sanity check would be, well, the dimension. So this u is d by little d. The x transpose, what is the dimension of x transpose? So x is d by n, so that I know. So this better be n by d, right? So d by n by n by d by d by d. What do I get? D by d, which is what I need. Okay? Good. And now minus here. The derivative of this guy. But again, this we already did before, and you asked me to erase it because I was ahead of myself. But roughly speaking, this is, again, lambda times u squared. The derivative of lambda times u squared would be 2 lambda u. So minus 2 lambda u. But I already explained that that doesn't make sense. The dimensions are wrong. So in fact, the lambda should be there. And that ought to be okay. So at the end of the day, what I get is the following. I need to get that x times x transpose times u is equal to u times minus lambda. For some reason, I ended up with the wrong sign, but that's okay. Okay? Is that clear? That's the equation that I got. X, x transpose u needs to be equal to u times lambda on the other side. Right? Okay, so a matrix times u is equal to u times a matrix. What does that remind you of? Huh? Eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Right? So I am sort of almost tempted, almost immediately, to say that u equals the matrix of eigenvectors of x, x transpose, and that lambda is equal to the matrix, or minus lambda, right, of eigenvectors. Right? Raise your hand if you agree with that statement. No one agrees. Raise your hand if you disagree with that statement. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, why do you disagree?
Well, we don't know that lambda is diagonal.
We don't know if lambda is diagonal. So what I said would be correct if lambda was diagonal. Okay? So this is potentially true, but, right? But I'm going to put a question mark. But we don't know if lambda is diagonal. Right? All we knew when we set out the problem somewhere before, over there, here it is that it is symmetric. But we don't know whether it's diagonal or not. Okay? So now is where I go back to what I had said earlier. The U matrix, we said it was not unique. It was only unique up to a rotation because we enforce that it's orthogonal. But I can replace u by r times u. And then I can have u transpose r in here. And I still get the identity, right? And actually, I can even do it in the other way around, which is
I can also have these and put an R there, an R there, and I think it's the identity because it's like I multiply, I will get R transpose R, and that's the identity, where R is a rotation. Or we did introduce this notation, O, D. So it's an just a rotation. It can be any orthogonal matrix. So this is the more precise statement. It's an orthogonal matrix of dimension little d. Okay? Right? That was an ambiguity. I said earlier on, the solution is not unique. There will be some rotation that I need to handle. And I said that that has to do with rotating the principal components inside the subspace. And inside the subspace is dimension little d, so this is exactly what I mean. There is this little d ambiguity that I can play with. Okay? So what I'm going to do is to actually take that equation, x, x transpose, and pretend that there was a different. And I'm going to, what if, you know, instead of u, I have u times a rotation? Then I would have here u times the rotation times minus lambda, right? And I could rewrite this equation as x, x transpose u is equal to u r minus lambda r transpose, correct? That's the same. So the solution is not unique. It's unique only up to our rotation, so I'm going to replace the orthogonal basis u by a rotated orthogonal basis. It will continue to be orthogonal. So that's why instead of u, I have u times r. And that's why instead of u, I have u times r. And then because r is a rotation, the inverse, you know, I'm multiplying the right by r transpose. The inverse of our rotation is the transpose. So I get that r disappears. And that r transpose shows up there. Is that clear up until now? Okay, and this is maybe a u tilde, if you wish, right? This is my u tilde. But look at what happened. Lambda was my matrix of Lagrange multipliers. All I knew is that it was symmetric. That's all I knew. We have said, and that's going to be your homework one problem, but I did state it in the review of linear algebra, that what is a particular property of symmetric matrices? Eigenvalues are real. That's one property. Second property, the eigenvectors can be chosen to be orthogonal. So when I look at the eigenvalue, the composition of a symmetric matrix, I can do it with orthogonal eigenvectors. Right? And so, this is the eigenvalue, the composition, of minus lambda, right? What was the eigenvalue of the composition? Let's remind. So any matrix can be written as the matrix of eigenvectors, a diagonal matrix, and the inverse. Right? That's what we said in class before. So as a consequence, this means that if you do B inverse A and B, you get lambda. So you can diagonalize a matrix. Given a matrix, if you multiply by the matrix of eigenvectors on the left and on the right, you get a diagonal matrix, right? That you learned in the algebra? Yes? Yes? Okay, so all I'm saying is, aha, you're totally right. I went ahead of myself. And this is not true, because we don't know whether lambda is diagonal or not. But what I can do is rotate the lambda on the right and rotate it on the left, and this will become diagonal. So there is a change of basis, or there is a rotation of the basis, that makes this be diagonal. Okay? So now, this one here, let me call it lambda tilde, which is equal to r lambda r transpose. This lambda tilde is diagonal. Okay? Maybe I should have been more careful. Maybe I should have said, just to be more precise on my notation,
I should have done a substitution where I'm going to call u to be u tilde r. So I'm going to call all of these u tildes. Okay. So the bottom line is that I end at the end of the day with x transpose u tilde is equal to u tilde minus lambda tilde, where this guy is now that. So, I have an equation that is almost eigenvector eigenvalue. The lambda isn't diagonal, but doesn't matter. I just rotate everything, and it now becomes that. So, because the solution is not unique, I'm going to pick one of them, and I'm going to pick the one that is based on the eigenvectors. And all other solutions will just be rotated versions. I'm not done though, because these eigenvectors of XX transpose, but which ones? Right? I know that u is d by little d. Right? So what I know is that the u is going to be u1 u sub little d. Okay? And I know that XX transpose as a matrix, this is d by n, and this is n by d. So this is a matrix that is d by d. So this matrix has capital D eigenvectors, and I need to choose little d of them. So which little d do I choose? Right? I don't know yet. So for that purpose, I need to go back to what is it that I'm optimizing. Right? If you go back to the final objective, and the final objective was written there, what I was trying to do was to minimize, the final objective was to minimize minus the trace of X transpose U transpose X. That was my very final objective, right? That's what I was trying to do. And what has happened? I now have this equation, but I've been able to demonstrate that. What do I know? I know that X transpose times U is equal to u times minus lambda. I know that. So can I substitute that into the objective, and what do I get? Okay? So maybe it's the same as minimizing minus, and I have probably played around already with some tricks. I would like to have something like x transpose u, so that I can substitute. x transpose u. Oh, that seems to be right there. Okay, so this was minus x transpose u, and so this is the same as minimize, and this quantity, now I can replace it, is u times minus lambda. Alright, and so now this is minimize, and the minus becomes a plus, and I'm going to get trace of lambda u transpose u, and this is minimize the trace of lambda. Did I get it right? I have a feeling that something is wrong.
So let me keep the minus lambda. So minimize minus the trace and minus lambda.
Yeah, it's the silly thing. I should have just started the Lagrange multipliers with the sign the other way around, and I wouldn't have been in trouble all the time. Because the eigenvalues are minus lambda, and so that's annoying.
Okay.
So this is the sum of the eigenvalues, right? Of x trans x x trans. Right? Lambda is the matrix, minus lambda is the matrix of eigenvalues. And the trace is just the sum of them. So I need to minimize minus the sum of the eigenvalues. That is equivalent to maximize the sum of the eigenvalues. Okay? So you've got a matrix that has capital D eigenvalues. And you are asked the following question. Select little d of them such that their sum is the largest. Which eigenvalues do you pick? Huh? The d largest. Okay? So choose d largest. So we end up with a theorem, then, which is what we are proving today, which is the geometric PCA theorem, that says effectively the following, that the solution to minimize over, actually I should say a solution, because we said that is up to our rotation. So this is xj minus mu minus u times yj 2 squared, such that the sum of the yj is equal to 0 and u transpose u is equal to the identity. That was the geometric PCA problem. So a solution to this problem is, so mu is just the average of the data points . The yj's is just the projection of the data points, of the centered data points, what the yj's are, okay. And u is equal to u1 ud, the top d eigenvectors of x x transpose, where x is the centered data matrix. So x1 minus mu, xn minus mu. That was what we have just proved. So the computation of the optimal subspace is really trivial and basic. The SVD gives me the solution in a sense. Computing the mean of the data, trivial. Then you compute the top d eigenvectors, so the centered of that matrix. And then you project the data onto the subspace, and that's how you get your principal component. Is that clear? Question?
So can you go over that again? So when you said that the eigen decomposition V inverse AV is lambda, if you multiply any matrix with the inverse of, forward multiply with the inverse of eigenvector matrix, mm-hmm. and backward multiply with the eigenvector matrix, you get a diagonal matrix. But here R is not exactly the matrix of eigenvectors, right? So how would you...
Yes, so what I'm saying here is the following. Any matrix can be written as matrix of eigenvectors, matrix of eigenvalues, and the inverse. Let's apply that to lambda. Lambda can be written as a matrix of eigenvectors. That matrix of eigenvectors I know is a rotation because lambda is symmetric. Okay? So I'm going to write that rotation there and denote it by R. Let me, I think to get this right, I need to be R transpose. Times lambda tilde times R. Let me repeat. You start with a matrix lambda that need not be diagonal. That's the original matrix of Lagrange multipliers. All I know is symmetric. It has an eigenvalue decomposition. That eigenvalue decomposition has a diagonal matrix in the middle and the matrix of eigenvectors and its inverse. That's what this equation says. Correct? And I know that the matrix of eigenvectors needs to be a rotation. That's why instead of the inverse, I put the transpose. Okay? So what this means is that now I can go from here to there and say that the matrix lambda can be converted into a diagonal matrix lambda tilde by pre-multiplying it by the its matrix of eigenvectors and post-multiplying it by the inverse, which is the transpose.
The choice of R here is a very specific R.
Yes.
Not any
R.
Yeah.
I am choosing the R that diagonalizes the matrix of Lagrange multipliers. But I know it exists, right? And so all what these theorems, that's why I wrote a solution to that problem is given by that. What are the other solutions? Are rotated versions. Okay? But they're all equivalent in the sense that they give the same objective value. Okay, where was I? I was supposed to erase this here, okay? So the last comment I wanted to make is the following. What is this matrix XX transpose? What is it? So, XX transpose, what is XX transpose? It's just X minus mu, X1 minus mu, Xn minus mu, times the transpose. Okay? So, I hope you can convince yourself that this is the same thing as the sum of xj minus mu, xj minus mu transpose. If I decompose that, it's a matrix product, but I'm going to do it column by column. Okay? It's going to be that. J equals 1 to n. Okay? And that equation, the way I've written it right now, should be somewhat familiar to you. Anyone can guess what that equation is? The covariance matrix. Is it the covariance, or if you want to be a little bit more specific?
Scaled. Sample covariance.
And sample covariance. Okay, so this is equal to n times sigma n, where this is the sample covariance of the data. Right? That's what it is. So this mu is the sample mean, and the other one is the sample covariance. All right, so the final solution is that you need to compute the scale. Does it matter, the scale? Like eigenvectors. If I have the eigenvectors of a matrix versus the eigenvectors of 2 times a matrix, does it matter? No. So the eigenvectors of this are therefore the same as the eigenvectors of the sample covariance. Is that right? Okay. What did we say in statistical PCA? We also ended up with computing some eigenvectors, right? What were the eigenvectors that we computed? Were the eigenvectors of the
covariance
matrix of the population, the true covariance matrix. Yeah, it was a random variable. Okay? And then I said, well, but the problem is that we don't quite have the true in reality. We are only given data and we need to sample. So we're going to approximate that statistical PCA by first estimating the variance or the covariance and then computing the eigenvectors. That's how we ended up, right? Look what has happened. We started with a completely different definition. It was a subspace. I needed to fit the subspace. I wrote down an optimization problem. I did these squares. I solved it. And what is the final solution? The final solution is the eigenvectors of the sample covariance matrix. So what this says is that geometric PCA, which is what we just did, is equivalent to statistical PCA, from the sample covariance. Okay? So, even though the definitions were completely different, these two notions are equivalent. So, fitting a subspace or finding principal directions is the same thing when you're doing it from a finite number of points. Right? And the last comment that I want to do, and this is going to be very critical for the homework, is the following. What is the dimension of this covariance? This is a matrix that is D by D, right? Correct? So in the homework, the D is going to be the number of pixels in an image. If you do what I just said, you're going to run out of memory. Okay? So, what we're going to do is exploit the following thing. The eigenvectors of XX transpose, okay, is the same as the singular vectors of X. Okay? We did go over that. There was a lecture that I talked about eigenvalue decomposition and singular value decomposition, and this was one of the things that I showed. Okay? So this matrix is D by D. So when the data is very high dimensional, not very efficient. This matrix is D by N. So a situation such as I give you 50 images of dimension 10 million. It's way faster to compute the eigenvectors, the singular vectors of this, than it is to compute the eigenvectors of that. Okay? Moreover, we don't need to compute all singular vectors, right? We just need to compute a few. We need to compute the top D. And so in the homework, I'm asking you to plot the top two. Right? So you also need to be very good at saying, well, I just need two. Okay. So I'm gonna do the homework for you. Okay. The easy part of the homework I'm gonna do right now, which is how do you do this in MATLAB, right? I'm gonna write the code for you so that you all have the homework done while on the way. So function. So we want to be u, we want to be u, we want to be y, and this is PCA applied to the beta x, and I need to give you the number of principal components or something like that.
right? So what you're going to do is to say that d, n is just the size of the data, right? Then you probably want to say that mu is equal to the average. So this is just the sum of x in the second direction and divided by n, right? Then you want to center the data. So you can do that by saying x minus mu times the vector of all ones, 1 on n, right? That's how you center the data. Then we're going to call the SVD the composition. So in MATLAB, that's already implemented for you. And it's called SVD of x. And now you can, in fact, okay, this I don't remember, so check for it. But I think you can tell MATLAB, just get me the top D. Or maybe there is a zero. I forget whether you can that or with a zero. So, you know, question mark, investigate, but just get me the top something. All right? If you don't want to do anything, just put this SVD of X. That will give you all of them. Okay? In fact, SVD of X now, I remember. You know, I did this 20 years ago. I think when you do SVD of x comma 0, what you get is just the rank of the matrix. So if the matrix is rank 10, then you get just get 10, instead of getting capital D, which is what you would usually get. Okay. And so now, the U matrix that you need to return is just the top D. So it's going to be column, comma, and 1 through these. That's how you get the top D singular vectors. And then the Y is U transpose X. That's what we proved in theorem. And that's all the PCA code that you need to do. So with 6 lines of code, that's all. Then you're going to say that I was lying, that you had to code a lot more. But I did a piece for you at least. All right? I just want to do it efficiently, but practice. I mean, do other things. Do it with for loops. Do it in other ways. And you'll figure out that in MATLAB, it's faster to do matrix multiplications. Of course, you can do it in C. Over there, you better do for loops. OK? All right? Have a good weekend.